Hello and welcome back to the Future Report podcast. My name is Holly Schaaf, and you might have heard a couple of times I've been the guest host. Well, Ashley Fell, our beloved Future Report host, comes on as the guest. And today we're going to be doing that as well as a bit of a different episode. Ashley and I recently traveled overseas to the U.S. We were there for just under 3 weeks for a few speaking engagements that she had locked on in over there, a few client meetings, and just a few things lined up. And so we just thought we would share some reflections from that trip, kind of touch on some of the trends that we noticed in terms of conference and travel post-pandemic, the content that we see as being particularly relevant over there, and what we kind of found to be, topics people are talking about, and also just a few more general reflections on the trip. And so we have Ashley here today joining us so we can chat about that together. Hi, Ash. Welcome back to the podcast.
Hi, Holly. Thank you. Our listeners and I are in for a treat with you. And again, stepping into the host role. So you're so good at it. So thanks so much.
Thank you. It's exciting to be here again. And this is a fun one for us to chat through. It was a very exciting trip with lots of different elements going on. We traveled to a few different places. So to give a bit of an overview, we started off going to Las Vegas. Ashley did a session over there with a wonderful organization. We were able to go to the Sphere. And then it was just a lot of fun. If you've seen anything about Las Vegas in the last probably 6 months, you've probably seen the Sphere. I don't know when they built it. Do you know when it officially started?
I can check. I'm pretty sure it was within a year or so. I just Googled it.
Within the year.
It opened on the 29th of September, 2023.
All right. There we go.
Less than a year, yeah.
Wow, very exciting. And it is just as crazy as it looks on social media. If you've come across any of those YouTube concert clips or anything from the Sphere, I know I sure did on my TikTok page. So that was a lot of fun. So we were able to do that as part of the session that Ash was doing there. So we'll chat a little bit about that and their intention for why we were able to do that in the first place as part of the conference. We headed over to Los Angeles. We were there for a few days, had a few meetings while we were over there, which was fantastic. And then we popped over to San Diego, where we were for a few days as well. That was for Kids Screen Conference, which was a main reason we were heading over to the U.S. to begin with. And Ashley facilitated a few different sessions while she was there at Kids Screen, and we had a few great meetings as well. And then we ended the trip in Nashville, Tennessee. So went on over to the other side of the country a little bit down more in the south there. And she did a session there as well as teeing up a few more meetings. So lots of travel, lots getting done, but it was a great trip. We learned so much. We're able to, meet so many fantastic people. And so it's a lot of fun that we get to share some of that today. Ash, is there anything that you think I've missed there, or any blanks that need to be filled?
No, you've hit all the main things. It was a lot of moving around, particularly the first week and a half. We really had a lot of meetings, a lot of events. We also had, when we were in Vegas, we had a Hulu documentary episode kind of called Impact and Times Nightlife reach out to us, and was just such a fluke that we were already over there when they wanted to originally do a media interview over Zoom, and then they're like, oh no, we'll send a crew out to where you are, to your hotel. So I did some media commentary for that as well while we're there. So that was a huge day in Las Vegas, as you recall, Holly. There was a lot of filming with the media crew, and then the keynote, and then more filming with the crew. So yeah, we kind of jammed it all in, but it was amazing. And I have had a few of these international conferences. They're a lot of work, and there's a lot of travel, but I love it. It's such a privilege, more than anything else. And it was so fun to have you on that trip with me, Holly. And yeah, so thankful you were there, because it ended up being a bit bigger than Ben Hur by the end. So.
Yes. No, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. I was happy to be there to assist in any way I could, because you were very, very busy with speaking, which was very exciting to be a part of. Lots of different organizations as well. I know we spoke for, there are for-profit organizations, not-for-profit organizations. We spoke to one as in like a technology development, software development organization, and then Kids Screen, obviously being kids entertainment industry there. With that. So there's a few different avenues and industries you're able to speak to and be a part of as well, which was just really exciting to see that all play out. Is there any, I guess, before we have a couple of key sort of insights or things that we are reflecting on that we wanted to talk about, but I guess, is there anything in the trip overall, Ash, that you kind of wanted to touch on or chat through, anything you found to be particularly interesting or exciting? Or I think it's your second time going to the US as well. So any just reflections in general?
Yeah, the US is such an interesting place. The first time I went was 4 years ago, basically to the day, because I was invited to go and be the keynote speaker at Kidscreen Summit in 2020. So in February 2020, I think I had left on the 1st or the 2nd of Feb. And then landed on the 16th of February. And then if people recall, it was about 3 weeks later in March when the world kind of imploded. And I might have shared this on the podcast before, but I remember for me, I knew that the pandemic and this COVID thing was going to be a big deal because I saw that, and I'm sure other people can relate to this, whether you've been to Times Square or not, but I had been to Times Square on that trip in 2020 and I'd been there with millions or whatever of other people and it was chaos and crazy and busy and bright lights everywhere. And then I was watching on TV that it was like a ghost town. It was just in lockdown. And I was like, oh, okay. That kind of made it real for me. I was like, no, I think this thing may be bigger than we anticipate. Yeah. But I remember even at the time, like my story that I tell is as well, like I was going over there and COVID was like a whisper. And I remember talking to my mom and I was like, do you reckon I'll need a mask? And she was like, probably not. Like, and I took some with me and we didn't end up needing them. But then for years and months after that, masks were a big part of our lives. So I think for me, it's amazing. And so many industries and so many professions were impacted by the pandemic. But the one that you and I currently work in today, Holly, and the one that I was working in 2020 is events, basically. Like we provide, you know, public speaker, professional speaker, keynote speaker solutions for hundreds of events every year. And that whole industry and the travel industry kind of got decimated by the pandemic. So I definitely had a few pinch me moments when we were away where I was like, oh, things are back and we don't have to wear masks. Like 100%. People sometimes opted to, but not many, I don't think. I didn't see many people wearing masks in our travels. Even like flights being back. I mean, we encountered some flight cancellations more than I've ever encountered, I think. So that was, I'd hear about people being like, flights get cancelled. I'm like, yeah, I know. And now I'm like, no, now I know.
She's like, no, now I take every flight that I have booked and hold it very loosely because of these experiences. You just never know, I guess.
I feel like we had a few experiences where we grew in resilience.
Yeah, exactly. That is a very positive, that's a half glass half full perspective there. So I appreciate it.
Very much so. But no, it's not that it was a full circle moment, but I think going back, being invited back to Kidscreen 4 years on from that, and that was kind of what they asked me to talk about actually, was the impact of the pandemic on Gen Alpha, which I know we'll touch on in a sec. But just it was so cool and it was amazing to see these really great conferences being run. Even the Sphere, like you mentioned, it was iconic, and it's filled my TikTok feed as well. And we were kind of like, oh, you know, we weren't actually sure that we were going to go, like but then a week before, the conference organizer was like, oh, as part of the conference we're going to watch like a documentary at the Sphere. And at times I was like, okay, this is steep. This is a little scary. It's like the IMAX theater in Sydney on like steroids. Just on another level. But no, it was amazing to go to that. I mean, that was our big day as well, our travel day. We just landed in Vegas after the big 14-hour flight and the time difference. And we went to the Sphere and met some people at the conference. Even just networking and the role that events play in human connection, in professional learning, development, but also being able to meet people. And we had so many other meetings as well, like you mentioned there, with current clients, prospective clients, people who just wanted to hear about Gen Alpha or our other research and our services. So it's something that I don't take for granted as much anymore. Absolutely. The travel and the events, because that was kind of taken away from us for a few years, but now
that's so true,
back bigger than ever. So it was such a delight to be involved.
Yeah, no, and you touched on some great points there, even in terms of events being such a space for connectivity, because I found that to be so true across every single event we were a part of and meeting and just everything that we got to be involved with. It was so great to be able to meet so many people from so many different places as well, not just the US, different places around the world. And it was really, very encouraging to see everyone leaning right back into that physical presence in a conference and I want to be there. And it's not really, I don't, at least from what I remember, there wasn't much of the kind of hybrid optional. We're zooming this session in. And so half of the people are up there and half the people are in the room. It seemed like it was fully, you know, if you're in the room, you're the one who's being able to take this all in and things. And yeah, it was really cool to see, even like what you mentioned before with the sphere, how the conference really integrated that into part of their overall theme, which was on innovation and looking ahead, what's next, what's kind of changing it. And the sphere is such a crazy, you know, innovation. And it's really, like you mentioned, it is like the IMAX on steroids, where it's just so crazy, so surreal. There was at various times, if you ever have the opportunity, I would totally encourage popping on over to Las Vegas. I know if you're Australia based, it's not really a popover. It's a 18 hour travel day at least. But it's just so surreal, feeling this real immersive experience. And it was just cool to see how they connected that current innovation there into the topic of innovation, which I know you spoke to as well. Your topic, I believe, for that session was innovation in people management. And so kind of looking at generations and all of that sort of thing as well. So it was just really cool to, yeah, be a part of so many live events where there were so many passionate people in the room that you could chat with and network with and make connections and bring those conversations even back to Australia. I know we've kept connected with quite a few of those people we met. So it's great to be able to have those experiences. And I guess just tying into that as well, Ash, I know one of the things we wanted to touch on is post-pandemic. I know you highlighted how obviously that has had such a significant impact on gathering, events, lives, you know, keynote, so much of what we do. And so in terms of what you kind of saw while we were there in the US, how is this conference and kind of travel industry after the pandemic looking like now that we're a couple years kind of out from those more intense restrictions and things in travel? You can go around, you can go to these places and spaces. So what are kind of your reflections in terms of, are we back? Is it looking different? What are you thinking there from the trip?
Yeah, I think, I think we're back. I think we've seen that in our work and the request and the demand for our services with regards to conferences and events. And yeah, people are filling the rooms. The rooms are full. People, I think, are eager to come back. And for a lot of these people, these events are kind of the first big ones back. Like maybe the beginning of last year seemed a bit too close. We were still a bit unsure if there was going to be another sneaky strain or issue. But now people are well and truly back. Live events are back, like live massive concerts, people, musicians touring again. And so business events are back. And I think, maybe not due solely to the pandemic, but I do think there are elements of events like sustainability, accessibility that I'm just seeing more and more of in the events that I'm a part of, in terms of how diversity is included, how simple the event experience is. Like, I mean, QR codes are the prime example of that. Like almost, I mean, we do it in every presentation. We have free resources or things that we'd love people to engage with that we just pop up on a QR code. Whereas like, you know, back in the day it was like, oh, and you can fill in this form or you can take a photo of this other thing. Whereas like, you know, the QR codes we had to all use to check in during those lockdowns are now used for other purposes, thank goodness, at conferences. But I think, it's amazing to see how much the industry has rebounded. And if anything, like I remember doing a presentation last year for Destination New South Wales, so here in Australia, and looking at even the amount of events, organisations, whether it's accommodation, services or hospitality, that do have staff shortages. So I think if anything, the demand's back to the point where we haven't got the staffing to kind of meet that demand, which hopefully is bodes well for that industry in terms of there is this real appetite for live events, immersive experiences, networking, less transactional, more relational content, but also how events are structured to allow for those moments of connection, moments of experiences. And I think that's the other thing that I've seen more and more of, the Sphere being one really amazing example, being in Vegas, just having that there. But I think for younger generations, they are looking to experience new things and things they might not be able to just get. Like you could just attend a hybrid conference or a masterclass online if you just want the key insights. But if you want to be entertained or, you know, talk to the people around you or hear other people's stories or experiences, live corporate events are a great place for that. So I think organizers are building that more into the structure of how they run events, not just keynote, 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 buy.
Absolutely.
It's networking, it's drinks, it's connections, it's chats, it's breakouts. And I think that's
so
a
true.
Great a great thing for, you know, the future conference attendee if it's more engaging in that way.
Yeah, you are spot on. That is exactly what I feel like we saw in pretty much every place and conference we were a part of, is those more immersive interactive experiences rather than, and network opportunities. I mean, I can even think at Kids Screen, there were so many opportunities and specific blocks that were, you know, taken out of the day for networking and for meeting and just being together and sharing a drink or sharing a meal, even ones that were not necessarily in the agenda. I know we attended one that someone we had met was just putting on, and having that community group there where you can go and meet new people. And it's so true what you mentioned as well, that you can only do, you know, if you just want the content, if you just want the insights or the keynote, and you can watch a video online, but it's such a completely different thing to be able to be in a room with people where you can turn and have a conversation about what you just saw, who they're, you know, equally as passionate about that, and you get to kind of share that experience. And it kind of even reminds me of with what I know you and Mark spoke about when you're talking about the Superiority trend, and how, you know, you can join a meeting hybrid, where, you know, you're getting to be a part of the meeting, getting to be a part of everything, the content of that. But then in terms of what the conversation's happening at the lunch table, for example, it's those sort of opportunities and points of connection that are sometimes you're not able to be a part of with just purely joining something virtually. So it is great to see that they are really leaning into the fact that if people are in the room, what can we actually do to make the most of their time here? How can we lay it out? So even when we, for example, had lunch at Kids Screen Conference, we're sitting at round tables with all sorts of other people. It was very hard to almost isolate yourself in that type of situation and just kind of go off on your own. We would be sitting at the lunch table and two people would join up and sit down and talk to us. And now we're having lunch with them and talking about what they do, and they're hearing about what we do. And it really, that it seemed to be very intentional in really curating those opportunities for connection and experience. So I think you're spot on with that reflection. That's great to hear. And I think the other kind of overarching theme that we wanted to touch on as well is the content that we noticed was really being picked up on in the US. Gen Alpha, generations in general, but particularly Generation Alpha, whom, if you listen to the podcast frequently or are engaging with our work at all, know that that is something that we care a lot about, is generations, but have particularly keen interest in Generation Alpha, of course. And so that was something that, even coming back and reflecting, I thought, you know, most sessions you presented or most meetings we had or conversations that we found ourselves being a part of, that was the content we were speaking on, was Generation Alpha, and you were sharing that content. So it'd just be great to hear a bit about your reflections on that, on the fact that Generation Alpha is a topic that is being so widely engaged with, it seems, in the US. We know we see that here in Australia, but in the US as well, and kind of what that means, what does that look like, and yeah, and what are kind of something we can take away from that.
Yeah, it's fascinating. I mean, many future-focused organizations have been thinking about the alphas for a while, but obviously every day more and more individuals, marketing leaders, CEOs, chief marketing officers, whatever the role is, more and more people are realizing that there is a new demographic coming through, and they're quite an influential one. And, you know, very soon, in just a few months, they'll be the largest demographic that we have, the largest generation. And we're talking about Gen Alpha, those kids born between, well, kids today, born between 2010 and 2024, who Mark McCrindle is credited with naming. And so I think because Mark and I have put out a lot of research about them on behalf of McCrindle, and we've co-authored that book, we do get a lot of really cool opportunities. And I do see particularly the US market as quite a forward-thinking thought leader in this space. I think a lot of organizations, a lot of requests we get for media commentary do come out of the US, because they are kind of, maybe it's the Silicon Valley futurist kind of vibe, but they are thinking about what's coming next all the time. That's not everyone in the US, that's a blanket statement, of course, yeah. But we do see a lot of conferences and conference organizers wanting us to come over and talk about Alpha, and that was what this was. And even with regards to the Hulu ABC kind of documentary, it was kind of, that was really fascinating as well, because it was basically their topic for this documentary episode was exploring the controversial trend of Gen Alpha's sophisticated skincare routines. Mm. And it was this episode for ABC Nightlife. And what the episode investigated, as you know, Hol, but for our listeners' benefit, was the trends shaping the lives of today's youngest generation, particularly around their early adoption of high-end skincare products. And it was remarkable to see in the finished episode, the finished product of that, how members of Gen Alpha are embracing social media to showcase their skincare routines. And this is sparking a lot of admiration and controversy in probably equal measure, and that's the tension for many leaders, for many parents, for many people who are trying to empower this generation to speak up and have a platform, but also to protect them and their naivety and their privacy. And so, yeah, these Get Ready With Me videos that, you know, seven-year-old influencers are creating with skincare products that are actually created for 30-year-old women like me, who have aging skin that these young kids don't have. Yeah. And so it's, yeah, I guess from those Get Ready With Me videos to the crowded beauty stores, these young influencers are making waves in the beauty industry, and so much so that they wanted to kind of investigate a lot about this generation and who they are. So, yeah, I was able to be interviewed for that, and I guess as someone who's been studying Gen Alpha for over a decade, it's been fascinating to witness their growing influence and their purchasing power. And we've talked about that before on this episode, even despite their tender age, like the oldest of them are only turning 14. That's pretty young. And they are really having a lot of influence, maybe and largely because of their early exposure to social media. They do have this knack for persuading their parents, and they are shaping these consumer trends. Mm. And it does come, this whole episode was talking about, along with this influence comes important discussions about their skincare safety, their impacts on their mental health, their views of themselves and their personal brand and beauty and self-expression and societal pressure. So I think it is important. Personally, I believe this, and I know many of our team do as well. It's important for us to navigate those kinds of conversations with thoughtfulness with regards to this development of this empowered generation. So that was kind of one really interesting idea where we're kind of, I think the world's kind of trying to grapple with and talk about and comment on this kind of global experiment of what happens when a whole generation of children in Gen Alpha are being socialized in a digital first world. So that was a really big component because of the media segment that I was involved with, that we were kind of orchestrating during our time in Las Vegas. During our short time in Las Vegas, there was a lot going on.
Short but packed.
As you know. And then the other big component was Kidscreen, which I mentioned I was a keynote speaker for that in 2020, which was kind of like, who is Gen Alpha? And the oldest of them at that point were 10. And now the oldest of them 4 years on are 14. There's some hardcore maths for everyone listening.
Yes.
quick math. 10 plus 4 is 14.
Yeah. Well but, done, Ash.
Thank you. But they, this year, you know, being a speaker returning to the same conference, they often want to make sure that attendees who come to this conference regularly are being told new insights and new information. And I guess that's the power of us as social researchers, is that we're often always updating insights and commentary, and there's always new trends. But this particular conference, they wanted me to come in and talk about the impact of COVID on Gen Alpha. And so I kind of explored a few key areas. There was digital integration, first and foremost, that this generation are more digitally integrated because of the pandemic, the impact on family and social connection for this youngest generation, the fact that they are more globally informed as a result of the pandemic, the impact on their education, and also their resilience. And I won't go through the whole keynote for everyone's benefit, but a couple of key insights. One that I found really interesting, I was referencing an externally driven research report, so we didn't particularly run this one, but it was looking at the transition of Generation Alpha from being digitally integrated to more virtually integrated. And that was kind of what I was talking about as a result of some of the stats I read and the stats I saw from this study. And it was interesting. They asked one question about what gamers in the US, particularly in the US market, of this generation want in their video games. And the number one thing they want is to build and create, followed by events that they can join in the game, followed by stories they can follow, and then items they can buy. And so it was 42% who want to build and create. And I think what we're seeing here is this virtual metaverse type world where kids are building worlds and creating solutions, and it's a lot more active rather than passive consumption of games and information. So I think that is going to have impacts on them, and that's kind of not COVID related specifically, but I do think the integration of gaming and digital and online learning, all of that has exacerbated the path this generation were on in terms of digital integration. So that was one really interesting one. The other one was amazingly, I guess, as well, that 26% of 12 to 15 year olds are listening to podcasts. So it's this idea that this younger generation are really engaging with this new form of auditory learning. And so keeping that in mind as well in terms of how they're engaging with the world around them. And the other one that I thought I would share that people might not have heard on the podcast before, because I only incorporated it into these insights for this presentation, was I found some global research, which was really interesting. And it was kind of looking at and putting some insights to something I've heard really anecdotally from a lot of teachers and educators I've spoken to in a work context, but also in my own life. A lot of my friends are teachers, and I talk with them about the impact of the pandemic on COVID. I mean, sorry, the impact of the pandemic being COVID on Gen Alpha, obviously. And this study was talking about lopsided learning, where they hypothesize that roughly half a year of learning has been lost for students in kind of year 3 to year 8. And so, of course, that's not evenly distributed. It's depending on opportunities and socioeconomic background and access to information. But also, it's not just learning. It's also the social interaction that comes from school, the non-work aspect that comes from school, not just literacy and numeracy, you know, figures or the writing ability or the things that we actually test. And so I think that was kind of something I shared, because it's been one of the first times I'd seen a quantifiable kind of impact of not going to school for those years. And I talked to so many people about that in my life, as I mentioned. So to see that research was interesting. So I shared that. But one more insight I think was, and I ended this on the presentation, was that the idea of resilience. And I think it depends who you talk to. Some people say, in light of that half a year of learning lost, which is really important in those formative years, Gen Alpha are less resilient as a result of the pandemic. But a lot of people also think, I think 78% of Australians believe that they'll be more resilient because they had to adapt and respond to these times of change, which have never been so rapid or fast or seismic as they have been with the pandemic. So there's lots of different ways to, and different lenses you can look at the impact of COVID on Gen Alpha, but they were some of them that I shared, particularly in this presentation. But I think we believe, and we always take this standpoint, the future is bright. Of course, this generation are going to encounter some unique roadblocks, but we do believe the future is bright for Gen Alpha.
Absolutely. Thanks for sharing all those insights, Ash. It was great to even hear, some of those key ones drawn out from that specific keynote that you did for Kids Screen, because that there was some fantastic content there. And I think it's even just very encouraging, I know you would agree, just to see all of this being held with such importance over in the US, in those communities, in those spaces, because we, of course, do so much work, like I mentioned before, in this in Australia, and get to share these insights you do so frequently in places in the education sector, for example, where these generation insights are so incredibly relevant, and do a lot of research and studies in this space. So it's very encouraging to have seen the trend across our time there, that people, most meetings we had, like I mentioned, that we got to speak about this topic, and people were so interested, where is Gen Alpha going? What is their hopes? You know, what is these resilience questions as well? And what can I do to prepare for the future and Gen Alpha as consumers? And it's just, it's really, really encouraging to see that work and that, those insights be really impacting those different sectors and spaces we are a part of as well. And I know that a lot of hard work goes into your presentations that you curate and create for these different individual organizations. So it was fantastic to be able to be a part of those, and as you shared them across a bunch of different cities. And so thank you so much for joining on today, Ash. It was great to be able to have a little bit more of a, I guess, fun or just reflection conversation around these things. But you shared some great insights there that I know we can all take something away from. So thanks. Thank you so much.
Oh, I'm glad to be, yeah, helpful. And yeah, thanks for listeners for letting us indulge, as you mentioned, a bit more of a chat about our trip. And yeah, I'm equally encouraged by the interest people are taking in this generation globally and here in Australia. So yeah, my pleasure, Hol, and thanks again for hosting.
Absolutely. Always a delight. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.